Kutam Ilunudi Zuamid. Welcome back to Channelglazes. We're down at the fortress bottom, watching our new squad train up in their open-air barracks. Much like with the silk gathering, this is a temporary setup, and once we've completed the bedrooms above, we'll set a proper dwarven barracks in the rock. With that said, allow me to introduce you to the mysterious tongs. Quite what affinity for grasping tools our dwarves have, I don't know. But I think it's fair to say that when they like something, they stick to it. I would have preferred a moniker with more of a martial tone to it, but let's just be thankful it isn't the mysterious lamps or similar. Now, we made Id our militia commander. Any who know Id would understand why. She's the dwarven equivalent of a brick. Solid, dependable, the type to stand with her peers and produce a wall to protect her fellow citizens. Though she's more corners than brain cells and a propensity to be bad for other people's teeth. Not sure which of those armoured figures is the dwarf in question, but I can tell you that she's been enjoying it, which is very good, as we've been hearing no end of bizarre noises from the cavern beyond the walls. Previously, I would have simply locked the doors, as I have here, and continued my existence free of the things going squaw, squaw. Channel Glazes will brook no such namby-pamby thinking, however, because the blasted fortress opens out into the cavern. The one piece of good news, stretching the word somewhat, is that I've managed to find my old phytoscope, and with a bit of ingenuity and a lot of tape, stuck it to my obsidian tablet of rewinding that the bus company very kindly posted back to me. So now we've got sort of a budget version of the old combat log from the ASCII days. What this means is we have a way of determining that there are apparently a contingent of formidably armed, though not legged, serpentmen and women slithering around, beating up the poor defenseless dwarf-eating cave trolls. I've never been so glad snakes can't fly in my eternal existence. Caves. I knew they'd be a damn stupid idea. This is what happens when I drink too much and let that idiot thimble talk at me. I mean, okay, I was definitely wrong about them just collapsing under the weight of all the rock from above. I still don't get that. But when you're building the perfect world for a race of creatures who like to dig through something, less of that something can never be a good thing. Murderland being one possible exception. Oh my, what are those things? Some sort of animal hybrid. Like a beastman, but just beast. A beast. They've got long bird-like legs, a big fluffy feathery body, then a meese end. With antlers and everything. Oh, wait. I remember these. Deer mules. No, wait. Goatstridges? Elk bird? Definitely one of Thimble's. There's a herd. Flock? Flurred. There's a group of them gathered at the northern end of the cavern. A handful have somehow gotten themselves wedged into a gap in the rock. I think it probably doesn't bear mentioning that they can't fly. Antlers aren't the most aerodynamic of bodily structures, after all. Which would explain the hideous pile of elkbird bits in the pool of elkbird juice on the cavern level below. poor things. Oh, but apparently they can jump. No, look, yes, just one more in there. Don't look down, you sweet abomination. Oh, bless. Hello, Your Highness. A trader's entrance again. I told you we think more of you than that. Honestly, the fact that you trek all the way out here personally is more than enough of a concession to... Oh, see, now if you'd gone in through the citizen's entrance, you would have discovered Thycutt was out gathering... Wait, she wasn't even... A new Fitbit, is it, Your Highness? Or did you just feel like tracking sand through our lovely fortress? Ugh, never mind. As for the traders, I'm not getting into specifics today. If you've seen one trade, you've seen them all. At least the Channelglazes recently. Perhaps in the future we'll focus on making a hyper-financial fortress. Imagine the fun of building a hoard. Ah. Anyway, yes, for now it's just the basics and nobody needs to see that. Except for Rimtar. But she loves the monotony. Don't ask her, just trust me. Big news on Project Big Egg! Here you can see we've set up something of an aviary for our humans. I don't know much about them, but I figured since they spend most of their time in the open air, they would appreciate a bit of a view. Hence the glass. Without the appropriate material, we can't of course call it a birdcage. So what do we think to the love jug? I'm a little put off by the visual language, jugs being a vessel for various fluids. Ugh. But otherwise, I think it shall do nicely. I've only been able to assign Emtha so far, but once we've figured out some... aphrodisiacs? I'm sure Ngojo will jump at the chance to cohabit. And the nest box is, of course, self-explanatory. So, I've left the dwarves to get to some basic tasks. We were running out of various odds and ends, and sometimes you just need to let the little sods get their bizarre urges out to reset the work orders. Whilst hovering above the temporary surface fortress, I couldn't help but notice we've begun to suffer from a very labour-lured issue. Cats. Big ones, small ones, they're filling the fortress with hair and dead vermin, and I want them gone. So if you look to the north, you will see a brand new butcher's workshop and a specific cat bit stockpile beside it to prevent any rotting issues. Down below, we've added a leather working workshop, so there's kitten mittens in our future, and I've lined up some luxury meals to be produced too. So prepare for cat stew. As lovely as these secondary results are, you just can't beat the ability to walk downstairs without treading in cat shit. I'm just glad my allergies are four-dimensional, so they only make me sneeze if I turn 13 degrees northwest widdershins relative to them on a Tuesday. A fun fact, all dwarves are 100% allergic to me as a deity, and within my presence will experience spontaneous combustion along with a contingent of other minor symptoms. Moving on, here you can see the military dwarves in their barracks. I thought they were training, but it would appear they are actually listening to a rousing speech which is being made by Onol. Let's take a listen. Next, you take your finely minced liver, add it to the cassava root that you finely minced, and mix both of them with the finely minced brains that we prepared earlier, to make, of course, the finest of roasts, rather than a bowl of random minced ingredients, as you might have expected.
What if you got no brains? Like that then?
I'm not having that. Come here, you little...
Oof!
Ow!
Laugh at me, will you?
You hit like a girl.
I am a girl.
I don't know what I was expecting. Donal isn't even the militia commander. That's his lover, Id, of course. Though, me knows what he gets out of that relationship. Literally, I know he's in defeat and hers are massive. Oh no, talking of bloody massive, take a look at this monster rat. I've no idea what it's doing. Seems to be panicking at the sight of all of our dwarven warriors. Which I wouldn't blame it for, but I've met them. Thinking about it, this'll be a good opportunity for our green fighters. Give me a moment. Yes, go and kill that horrible thing! Holy, that was actually done with no small amount of efficiency! Perhaps my concern was unfounded. Perhaps we can send the warriors out without worry or delay. Perhaps... what's that sound? Oh. My. Me! So that's where I put you! Allow me to introduce Arak Bugsud Ral, the Blisters of Submerging. I was making french fries in the nude, that is to say, with my god turned off, and accidentally dipped my tallywhacker in the boiling oil. The curse word I uttered deafened the neighbor's cosmic antelope and created this little goalie boy. I'd completely forgotten all about him. Oh look, he's going for a little swim after murdering who knows how many serpentmen. Don't overexert yourself, Arak. You know how crumbly you'll get when you're wet. Oh, he's dead. Ah well, at least he thinned the herd. Oh, they mangled his coal. I'm going to need a minute. Oh, my poor useless beast. Take a look at this. He had poisonous breath, which, due to the mechanics of such a thing, led to him continuously being caught in a cloud of his own boiling extract. Because, I mean, of course it did. You hear breath attack and imagine gouts of the stuff, but envision having to attack something by breathing on it. Halitosis notwithstanding. Hopefully this means the cavern will have calmed down. Not that I'm going to be throwing our dwarves out into the darkness just yet. No. I think we need to let them spend a little more time training. Perhaps wait for a few more migrant waves to fill out some redundancies. Ghoulish perhaps, but channel glazes must go on. Oh, here we have something for our freshly blooded warriors to do though. Some more giant frips. I've set the warriors to attack mode, so let's just follow along and watch the mayhem. Four! Look at all of that bug juice. Oh, and oh no, Catton appears to have been injured. Nil's got her though, carrying her down the trade entrance into the small hospital. Ugh, would you look at how disgustingly chipper she's being. Oh good, here's Einod, our chief medical dwarf. We should be able to see what's wrong now. Oh, that's a nasty wound to her left ankle. And of course, she's already up and about. What an absolutely ridiculous dwarf. Well, at least she's oh, come on! See, this is exactly why you are the worst. Always pushing past your limits and overcoming your adversities. Look, her greaves were removed with the impact. And now she's just going to complete an individual combat drill. Probably with accompanying music for a montage. Well, that just won't do. We'll have to find a replacement for her. But first, look at this! We've managed to capture our very own giant thrips, and I know the perfect place to put it. Right here, in pride of place, in the center of Channelglaze's own candies of wire. Ah, yes. Isn't it strange how these things tend to work out? Before Channelglazes, I couldn't tell you what a thrips even was, but now I'm honestly thinking of getting out and manifesting a garden to draw some in. They're not big, they're not pretty, but by me have they not stolen a teeny tiny piece of my heart? Back to Catton for a moment, and would you just look at this sickeningly bubbly dwarf? She's currently satisfied upon improving her crutch walking. Who else but Catton, eh? I must admit, she is getting pretty good with it. Yes. Hobble, you filthy little optimist. Can't help but notice your sock is half full. That's a good one. Well, it's getting to be about that time again. The human caravans have arrived once more, and so, with the sounds of them in the background, we shall say our goodbyes. Though, should probably mention, regarding Catton's replacement, I went with Kol Kol. She's bloody useless for anything else, and with all her free time, she started to emulate the cats, and I can't keep asking the other dwarves to clean her leavings off the stairs, so... Yes. And with that delightful thought, I shall leave you. Do make sure you take care, and I hope to see you next time. Nanus Ashon, my friends. Nanus Ashon. We did it! Absolutely smashed the 100 subscriber mark, and we're well on our way to 200! I can't thank you all enough, but I do, and from the bottom of my heart. Anybody new to Crumpet Sounds? All the cool kids are subscribing. Just saying.